أما بعد،
فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ومن آياته أن خلق لكم من أنفسكم أزواجا لتسكنوا إليها وجعل بينكم مودة ورحمة، إن في ذلك لآيات لقوم يتفكرون.
صدق الله العظيم. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has made us part of a gathering that is about to witness a beautiful bond of nikah. So generally these lectures that we have, say before a nikah ceremony, or else even if you were to take the weekly khutbah, it is all about talking that is something pertinent to the events that surround it. Say we are having a nikah ceremony, we talk about the nikah or things that are relevant to nikah. Likewise, the weekly khutbahs, the khatib would generally address an issue which is surrounding the Muslim ummah or that society at that moment and at that time, so that he can educate himself. Likewise, the masses in regard to what to do in that situation, as to how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the beloved Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in acted in that circumstance. So if we were to take nikah, in today's short talk, I wish to highlight a few things, primarily being in regard to the purpose of life, in regard to rectifying your intention, rectifying your intention and acknowledging that nikah is an ibadah. Number three, maintaining the levels of rahmah and mawadda. And finally, on how two spouses should be on common grounds in regard to their interests. I'll just take a few minutes. So in regard to the purpose of life and nikah, how do we join these two things together? The purpose of life and nikah. Today, sadly, if we were to look around the Muslim ummah at large, or rather the world, what has happened is, due to the indoctrination of movies, books, whatever you take, people think of marriage as an end. People think of marriage as an end, not as a means towards an end. There are two differences. You take marriage as an end or as a means towards an end. Let me explain. You take a movie, for example, there is a hero or a heroine. In a book, anything you take, what they give you the idea there is that there is a damsel in distress, a heroine who is facing problems, who is struggling perhaps, and the hero comes into the scene, he saves the girl, they marry one another, and how does the story end in movies and in books? They live happily ever after. They live happily ever after. So this is the belief that is indoctrinated in everyone's mind, that right after marriage, you live happily ever after. So the minute there comes a small problem or a small issue in a relationship, what happens is both the spouses, they can't take it, because they were looking at marriage as it is going to be something else, you know, it is sailing off into the sunset. No, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, rather marriage comes with its set of responsibilities. Marriage comes with love, marriage comes with duties, marriage comes with responsibilities, marriage comes with sacrifices. And mainly, we need to internalize that marriage is a means towards an end. For if we internalize this concept, that marriage is a means towards an end, there is no issue whatsoever. No problem at all. For the purpose of this whole life, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, every single thing that we do in this life is a means towards an end. And what is the end? The pleasure of our beloved maker, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is our end. That is our goal. That is our objective. Marriage is a means. It is a vehicle. It is a mode of transport to get you from point A to point B. To get you to the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is an ibadah that will take you to the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is in general, in a nutshell, the whole purpose of life. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about why He created mankind and jinnkind. He says nothing other than ibadah. Nothing other than the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But that does not mean that we spend our whole lives in the masjid. That does not mean we spend our whole lives in sajidah. No. Islam is such a beautiful religion, such a broad religion, that so many things, whatever we do to win the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is considered an ibadah. Nikah is an ibadah. And not only that, my dear brothers in Islam, even the intimate relationship that takes place between a husband and a wife, it is considered an ibadah. I don't think there is even one religion on the face of this earth that considers the intimate relationship between a husband and a wife as an ibadah. The morsel of food you put in your wife's mouth is considered as sadaqah. This is how beautiful Islam is. Every single thing that we do, it is an ibadah that we look to win the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this we need to internalize. And for that, let me mention a beautiful story to highlight that fact. This is the story of Zubayr radiallahu anhu. Zubayr radiallahu anhu, he is Zubayr ibn al-Awwam. Zubayr ibn al-Awwam. Zubayr radiallahu anhu, he was very close to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that too in many ways. Number one, his mother was Safiya radiallahu anha, who was the daughter of Abdul Muttalib. Abdul Muttalib, the grandfather of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that makes Zubayr radiallahu anhu the cousin of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, number one. Secondly, he was related through Khadija radiallahu anha, was his aunt. Khadija radiallahu anha was his aunt, making Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam his uncle. He was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's cousin. Likewise, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was his uncle. And finally, he married Asma bint Abi Bakr radiallahu anha. Asma radiallahu anha, who is the sister of Aisha radiallahu anha, who is the beloved wife of our Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that makes him the brother-in-law of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Three relationships he enjoyed. Allahu Akbar. Such a great sahabi. So much to the extent that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to call him that he was from the Hawari and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the disciples of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Umar radiallahu anhu used to address him as Ruknul Iman. He was a pillar of faith. A pillar of faith. Zubayr radiallahu anhu. He lost his father when he was very young. And his mother Safiya radiallahu anha used to bring him up in such a manner that she trained him to become a warrior. She used to beat him, she used to treat him very harshly. So much to the extent that his uncle once went and complained to the nobles of his tribe in regard to how his mother was treating him. When they approached her, she said, I'm not beating him or treating him harshly out of enmity or hatred towards him. No, I'm doing it to make him a wise and great warrior. She had a noble objective. So Zubayr radiallahu anhu, he becomes known as the knight of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Once when he was 16 years old, there was a rumor spread around where he was that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was taken captive or perhaps murdered. The minute he heard this news, he brandishes his sword, 16-year-old boy. He brandishes his sword and rushes to the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sees him and calls him, my brother, Why are you with a brandished sword? He goes on to say, Ya Rasulullah, I heard that the people of Mecca have planned some harm to you, or that they have harmed you. So I am here announcing war against the whole of Mecca. I'm ready to face them to defend you. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked at his sword and says, this is the first sword. This is the first sword to be brandished for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his beloved Rasul. Allahu Akbar. His strength, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, used to be so immense, so strong, that when he was in the battlefield, whilst running in the horse, if he were to strike his enemy with the sword, he used to chop the person in half, right in half, and the sword used to go through until even the saddle of the horse, and the saddle used to split into two. This was his strength. And this is why he was known as the knight of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So now we must be wondering, how is this pertinent to marriage? He marries Asma radiallahu anha. He marries Asma radiallahu anha. And he used to be a person not bothered about this dunya. This dunya was nothing for him. He used to be most of the time spending his time in jihad and other things which was in relation to striving the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Asma radiallahu anha used to face a lot of difficulties because financially it was not that well off. She had to tend to the animals, she had to gather firewood, she had to draw water from the well. Once she's coming, taking some water or firewood and she's walking, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is passing by. He sees her and he offers her a lift. He offers her a lift. Perhaps he was in a caravan or something like that. She refuses to go with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, saying, Ya Rasulullah, my husband will not like it. My husband will not like it. Because Zubayr radiallahu anhu used to be a very possessive man. He used to be very possessive. So much to the extent that he could not even bear his wife going with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because he was so possessive. She goes and mentions to Zubayr radiallahu anhu that this is what happened. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam offered me a lift. And then he goes on to say, you know, it was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There's no issue, but still I feel sorry for you. You know, I am possessive of you, but I also feel sorry for you. Because I don't have the financial means to look after you in a way where there you won't have to tend to the animals and gather firewood and draw water from the well. Now the story goes on. Scholars mention that she was facing a lot of difficulties, a lot of hardships. Finally, so much to the extent, she goes to her father, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and tells him, oh my beloved father, life is hard. Life is harsh for me. I'm finding it very difficult with Zubayr radiallahu anhu, because financially we're not well off. And also I have to tend to the animals, and all of these hard chores are upon me. And you know what Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu advises his daughter? Today, what would the father-in-laws do? First thing, perhaps they would get down the daughter to their house. Or what would they do? They would say, no, you know what? I'm going to spend on you. I'm going to spend on you. And what would happen? The son-in-law is obviously going to take advantage of that fact. He's going to take advantage. Even if he has money, now he's going to live on the father-in-law's money. You know what Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu advised her? Oh my beloved daughter, this life, this transitory life, temporary life is nothing. You know who you are married to? You are married to the knight of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Just imagine what your status and what your rank would be on the day of Qiyamah in Jannah. Allahu Akbar. This was their goal, not this dunya. Don't fret over these petty issues of dunya. This materialistic dunya which is nothing. You are perhaps going to live for 60 or 70 years. You can bear the hardship, for you have indeed married a great person, where you will be honored much on the day of Qiyamah and in Jannah. The reason being, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, they understood the purpose of this worldly life. They understood the reality of dunya. They knew that this world, this life that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you and me, is not a life to live. The problem we face today is, we think this is the thing that we have to earn. This is the only life we got. But in reality, you are going to spend 40-50 years of your life hankering behind this dunya, amassing millions, building houses, buying cars, and finally you are going to leave this dunya, someone else is going to enjoy that wealth. Whilst your bank account there is going to be zero. For if you were to say one subhanallah, you are going to get a golden or a silver tree in Jannah. That is where you need to be placing your investments. Those are solid investments. No recession, no bankruptcy. That is an assured investment. And that only will happen, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, if we understand the reality and the purpose of this life. The Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, they understood it. Now secondly, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, in regard to rectifying our intention and considering nikah as an ibadah, I'll just wrap it up with that because we're running short of time. Rectifying your intention. I'm talking to the groom, likewise the crowd at large. For all those who are married, you can also rectify your intentions. And the brothers who are going to get married, you can place your intention in a proper manner. Why are you getting married? Or why are you going to enter into the aqd of nikah? Why are you going to sign on the dotted line? Ask yourself, each one who is going to get married, ask yourself, is it because of the BMW 5 Series I'm going to get? Or is it because of the apartment in Colombo 7 I'm going to get? Or is it because of the job my father-in-law has secured? Or perhaps the paddy fields he's going to give me? Why? Or is it because I love this girl? Or because she is a raving beauty? She is a bombshell? Why? Why? Ask yourself. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, I don't need to go into the materialistic part of it, you know, whether it is for some gain of dunya. But if it is for love, you mark my words, write it down and know one thing. Love before marriage is nonsense. Love before marriage is an infatuation. It is not true. It is a mirage. It is fake. Love before marriage. You should not marry the one you love, but rather love the one you marry. Don't marry the one you love. Love the one you marry. Love after marriage is what is real. Why? Because you are in a relationship, you are in a love relationship, which is haram. No grounds for it in Islam, no room at all, it's haram. But hypothetically, for an example, you are in a relationship. How is this relationship today? It's either going to be on a WhatsApp conversation, or perhaps a Facebook Messenger, or perhaps Skype. This is how the relationships are today, or perhaps in coffee shops. You're going to be in a relationship. Love, Romeo, Juliet, Layla, Majnun, they can't live without one another. They marry, and sadly in 7 months we hear now they're headed for a divorce. What happened? Where is the love? Where is the Layla, Majnun, and where is the Romeo, Juliet? The reason being, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, you did not live under one roof. You can't run a relationship on WhatsApp. You can't run a relationship on Facebook Messenger. In the morning, the girl is going to get up and take a beautiful picture of her and WhatsApp it to you. You're going to look at it and wow. And when you are going out, you are going to wear your shades and send a picture to her and she's going to be dazzled. But the minute you enter into a nikah, you come under one roof, now life begins. Like I said, marriage is not only about love. Marriage is about duties, marriage is about responsibilities, marriage is about sacrifices, marriage is about compromises. Now you enter, before when you were WhatsApping, I don't care even if you place dal for me, I'll just drink it and I'll go. You don't have to cook anything for me, I love you so much. But now after the marriage, if there is no salt in the curry, the plate goes flying. If there is no sugar in the coffee, there is a problem. For the wife, if the men are generally messy, no offense to anyone, but if the towel is thrown somewhere, that is blown out of proportion. Small issues are blown out of proportion so much to the extent that it leads to a divorce. I'm serious. Small issues. Perhaps the man is snoring, that becomes an issue. The toothpaste wasn't squeezed properly from the bottom, it was squeezed from the middle, that becomes an issue. The towel is thrown there, the socks are thrown here, that becomes an issue. The reason being, they haven't understood what marriage is all about. For if they do understand what marriage is all about, you would tolerate. You would tolerate. For our nikah, the nikah that is about to take place now in a few minutes, and likewise all of our marriages, nikah is something so beautiful, it has been sealed in the heavens. The matchmaker is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and our nikah, our marriages are not like the kuffar say, till death do us part. No. Our marriages are supposed to last for an eternity, not even till death, for an eternity. Why our marriages begin in this dunya and even go on in the akhirah? Even to the next world. Allahu Akbar. Even to the next world. So how do we maintain these marriages, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam? You start off by keeping the proper intention. And that is what? This is a means towards the end. This is a means to get to the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And entering into this marriage, into this bond, into this aqd, for nothing other than the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to save myself from haram, from that which is going to displease my maker. This is your intention. And afterwards, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, you do every single thing that would help to maintain, to concrete, to strengthen this marriage. There are so many things, and I don't have time to touch on all of them. There are so many things where you can follow the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, become a husband like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, follow his teachings, adopt his lifestyle as your lifestyle, and you will be successful in this world and the hereafter. One tiny example, and I'll wrap it up. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he taught us that when you call your wife, address her with sweet words, sweet expressions. This is one ingredient towards a happy marriage. Why? Because in Sri Lanka, we in general, what happens is, perhaps maybe not in Colombo, but outside of Colombo, what happens is generally people address their wives using pronouns. Or the wives address the husbands using pronouns. Avar or avan, enanga, these pronouns. Okay? This is not from the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look at how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam addresses his wife. How does he call Aisha radiallahu anha? Her name is Aisha radiallahu anha. He calls her Aish very lovingly. Aish. And in another narration, Ya Humaira. Now Humaira is not her name. Humaira is a nickname that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used for her, which means, O rosy-cheeked one. O rosy-cheeked one. This is what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is teaching you and me on how we are supposed to address our wives. So there is no harm in calling your wife honey. There is no harm in calling her cupcake, sugar, sweetie. All nice names. You can and you should. The other day, I'll just share this joke, I was reading that you're not supposed to call your wife sweet names. You're not supposed to call your wife using sweet names. You're not supposed to call her honey, you're not supposed to call her cupcake, sugar, sweetie. Because if you do, you stand a chance of getting diabetes. So don't call her using sweet names. Use healthy, bitter names. Like what? Go to call her Pawaka. Use all, you know, healthy names. So that will keep you healthy. Allahu Akbar. No, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Rather, we follow the teachings of our beloved Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We don't call different names and the names of animals and all of these things. After all, that's our spouse, our life partner, our mate. When I said our marriages are supposed to last for eternities, everybody's face is like this. Why? They're now thinking, oh my God, do I have to live with her in the next world too? No, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, marriage is a bond, is an ibadah that we need to enjoy. We need to enjoy. We need to be happy. The ayah says, لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created for you mates so that you may find peace with them. You may find tranquility. وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. And Allah has placed love, mercy, affection and all of these between you all. This is the purpose why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created spouses for us. Allah could have created us in a way that we could reproduce by ourselves. We wouldn't need a mate. Haven't you ever thought about that? Why do we need a mate to reproduce? Or why the sexual reproduction manner, why is it in that way? Why did Allah create it as such? There are some single-celled amoeba, organisms that reproduce by themselves. There are worms that reproduce by themselves. They don't need a mate. They can reproduce by themselves. Allah could have created us in a way that we won't need a mate. But no. In His infinite wisdom, in His infinite might, He created mates for us. So much to the extent that our father Adam alayhi salatu wasalam was not happy until he got Hawa alayhi salatu wasalam. This is from the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is up to us to condition our marriages, strengthen our bonds so much to the extent that we please our maker, resulting in that bond becoming fruitful and we getting beautiful, obedient children will be a coolness to our eyes. So with that, I wrap it up, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless the union that is about to take place in a few minutes. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless their marriage, to bless both the spouses, husband and wife, fill their hearts with love and unite them forever. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them with children, beautiful, obedient children who will be a coolness to their eyes and who will be a benefit to Islam and this society. Wa akhir da'wa ya'ni alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.